this particle has to do with variceal bleeding. Variceal bleeding is certainly quite a serious problem because these patients tend to be quite ill. And the first thing is to know that around half of the patients who have cirrhosis will develop at some time evidence of varices. And the frequency of varices is much higher if the patient is more advanced, it's more decompensated. Child C, 85% of them will have varices, versus child A, around 40% of them only will have varices. And the varices form little by little, and it's estimated that around 5 to 15% of the patients will develop, as time goes on, a year, varices. And it's expected that around 30% of the varices will bleed at some time, and the first time they bleed usually is around 3 units of blood. That's in average what you expect to see. Esophageal varices only bleed when the pressure is high enough to cause bleeding, and we know that the threshold for that is 12 millimeters of mercury. We consider clinically significantly portal hypertension 10 millimeters of mercury, but for you to bleed, you need to have 12. For that reason, whenever we treat the patients trying to drop the pressure, we try to bring it to around 10, when the patients will have still a decent amount of flow to the liver, but will not be likely to bleed. The risk of bleeding depends on the size of the varices. If you have F1, that means less than 5 centimeters or less, the around 10% of them will bleed a year, versus if the varices are larger, F2 or F3, F2 is 6 millimeters, but if less than a third of the lumen of the esophagus, and F3 is more than 6 millimeters, each one occupying more than a third of the lumen, now the risk is 30% per year. The mortality for each episode is meaningful, around 20% per episode, and if you don't decide not to treat the patient, they are likely to keep having episodes, and around 70% of them will die within the year, not only because of bleeding, but also because just of the decompensation. Now, why larger varices bleed? And this has to do with physics, like almost everything in life, Laplace's law. And Laplace's law says that the tension on the wall is directly proportional to the pressure and the radius of the container divided by 2. That means that as the radius of the lesion goes up, as compared here, like in this part of the balloon versus this little part of the balloon, the tension is going to be much higher, and the tension will arrive to the point of maximal tolerance, and then it will explode. And that's why you try to shrink varices. That's why we do endoscopy and band them or inject them, just to shrink them in some degree. And this is the classification of varices. They can be F0 when you think it's there, or maybe not. You don't see any clear evidence. F1, small varices up to 5 millimeters. F2, 6 millimeters or more, taking less than a third of the lumen. And when it's more than a third, is going to be F3, and all this is important from the prognostic point of view, because F3 will bleed more than F2, and the bleed tends to be much more severe. Now, who needs, once a patient has cirrhosis, it's very important to find if they have varices, and that's why anybody who has cirrhosis is going to have at different intervals endoscopic examination to try to define if they need to be treated. The annual rate of bleeding is around 12%, and again, the ones who are at most meaningful risk of bleeding are the ones who are larger than 6 millimeters, that means F2, and in that case, you are going to be using any of these forms of therapy, beta blockers or endoscopic therapy, and all of the patients, you are going to ask them to lose weight if they are obese. Or small varices that have a high risk. And the high risk is a patient who has varices that are less than 6 millimeters, but are presenting a child pew C patient, or who have red well marks. That means there is these red spots over the varices. That is vasovasorum that are perforating the wall, and they are ready, they have debilitated the wall, and for that reason they are more likely to bleed. In addition to that, weight loss is also an important recommendation if they are obese. The choice of what you are going to use, if you are going to use a beta blocker versus endoscopic therapy, is going to depend in many ways on what the patient prefers, or how compliant you think the patient is going to be, because if patients are not going to be taking the beta blockers every day, they may be better being in scope. And then once you place the patient on therapy, you don't have to keep doing the endoscopy unless they will bleed. If you're already placing in beta blockers, they don't need more endoscopy. If you decide to do endoscopy, then what you do is eradicate, and you do several episodes until they are very small, and then you have to look every 6 months to see how fast they are growing back to decide you need to treat again. What is not recommended in this situation is to combine beta blockers with band ligation or to do a TIPS in patients who have never bled yet. This is the official recommendation from the American Association of Study of Liver Disease of how to utilize the drugs in primary prophylaxis. And you can see here the drugs that are utilized are propranolol, nadolol, and carvedilol. And if you choose to do an endoscopy, it's going to be just endoscopic variceal ligation. And it's what I mentioned before about the intervals, and if you continue not doing endoscopy. The dose of propranolol usually starts with 20 to 40 milligrams twice a day, and then every 2 to 3 days you go up until you get a pulse of 55 to 60 while keeping the systolic pressure 90 or higher. And you usually, if the patient has ascites, you try not to exceed 160 milligrams, but if they have ascites, if they have no ascites, you can try to go up to 320. Nadolol, similarly, you go every 2 to 3 days, start with 20 to 40 milligrams once a day, and here the maximal dose in patients without ascites is 160, and the ones in patients with ascites is going to be 80, always with a target of pulse of 55 to 60, and keeping the systolic pressure higher than 90. Carvedilol is the simpler one, and it's the most effective one of them. And you just start with 6.25 milligrams once a day, and after a few days you go to 6.25 twice a day, and then you say thank you. And that's it. You just keep the patient in this dose, you don't look at pulse, you don't look at anything. But this drug tends to decrease pressure more, for the reason you will find more patients who cannot tolerate it because of systolic blood pressure drop. Now, once you have a patient and you do your first endoscopy, there are several possibilities. You may find that the patient has no varices, or they have small varices, or they have larger varices, and then you have to decide what the heck you're going to do. And this is the official recommendation that came from the Baveno Conference in 2015. If the patient has no varices, then you try to see if the patient has cirrhosis that is active or inactive, and if the patient is compensated or not. If the patient is decompensated, you look once a year. If the patient is compensated, but the disease is not controlled, let's say the patient has NASH and is not losing weight, or is not taking the medication for whatever therapy, you try to treat hepatitis C and was not successful or whatever, this patient needed every 2 years. But if you treat and cure the underlying disease, then in 3 years is enough. If the patient has small varices and is a ChAl-PUA, now the intervals are just a little shorter, but the division is similar. Decompensated 1 year, compensated with active injury also 1 year, and the ones with quiescent disease will be 2 years. And once the patient has more disease than this, they are going to be treated. If they are small varices with red well or child B or C, you are going to use beta blockers. And this is because it's very difficult to band when they are that tiny, that doesn't work very well. If they are medium varices, F2, and ChAl-PUA, most of the time you're going to do a beta blocker, but if they are ChAl-PUB or C, you can choose one or the other, and that's the way the patients are going to be treated. You could screen patients just doing FibroScan, looking at the resistance, and if the resistance in FibroScan is less than 20 kilopascals and the platelet count is more than 150, that has a predictive value of around 98% that the patients do not have meaningful varices and you don't have to scope them. Once the patient has varices, they may have the bad taste of trying to die, and they may come bleeding. Now, if the patient comes bleeding from varices, around half of them are going to stop spontaneously. But you have to look at if they are in any of these categories. The patients may go and evolve to a therapeutic failure. That means you try to do whatever you want, and they are likely to keep bleeding and rebleeding very quickly in the initial few days. Or they may have a high risk of early rebleed, and we will try to see what identifies these patients. Or they may have just look at an average patient, and then you say, oh, okay. Now, the risk of rebleeding is highest in the initial 48 hours and remains quite high up to around day 5. And that's why you usually keep octreotide or any other drug, vasoactive drugs, during the initial 5 days. The inpatient mortality is around 40%. Some of them, and they can die from different reasons, not only from bleeding, maybe just that they get infected, or just the disease decompensates, so they develop a runner syndrome. And the survival, if they are able to survive 2 weeks, then around half of them will be alive at 1 year. Now, there are some things that predict that the patient is likely to continue bleeding on the initial 5 days, and that is called the failure to control acute hemorrhage. And one of them is at the time you scope the patient, the varices is spurting, they have a higher risk of rebleeding. Or the patient is a child PUC or have portal vein thrombosis, and that's why you tend to do a Doppler when these patients come. Or if they are infected, because that increases thrombolysis, or if the patient has very high portal pressures. Most of the time, we don't measure the pressures, but we know that 80% of the child PUC will have pressures in excess of 20. And here we have, what are the odds of bleeding or rebleeding or continued bleeding in the initial 5 days according to this pressure. If the pressure is less than 20, we have it in blue, up to the mortality will be up to 20% with an early rebleed of 12% and continuous bleeding of none. Versus the pressure is more than 20, the continuous bleeding will be 24%, early rebleed 50, and mortality is going to be 62%. For this, that is a strong predictor of what's likely to happen. And the second group that tends to be relatively early are the ones who do it from day 6 to up to the initial 6 weeks. And this can be identified because of multiple factors. Age, the presence of ascites, the presence of infection, the presence of renal failure, very low hemoglobin, high pressures, active bleeding at endoscopy, red color signs, that's markers over the varix, a platelet clot at the time you do endoscopy, thrombocytopenia, encephalopathy, that is a lot of patients that are admitted for risk of rebleeding. And the ones who don't have anything like that, you say, oh, great, they are less likely to get in trouble. Now, what should you do? The patient comes to you, and you think that he's having bleeding from varices. But the first thing you are going to do is you are going to place the patient in antibiotic prophylaxis. And this is for multiple reasons. And then you are going to place the patient in a vasoactive drug that in the United States is going to be octreotide, because we don't have terlipressin, we use octreotide, and we don't have somatostatin either. But both of them are quite similar. And then you are going to try to do an early endoscopy in the initial 12 hours, as I mentioned before, in order to do therapy. You are going to go and do restrictive blood transfusions, and you have to think, does this patient need an early TIPS or not? And I will go over the criteria when you will do an early TIPS. It's also important to evaluate the portal vein for portal vein thrombosis and look for evidence of hepatocellular carcinoma, because the situation is much worse on these patients. It's important, as I mentioned before, that there are no recommendations about, there is no clear recommendation about giving platelets or not to these patients. Usually they have large amount of platelets. The count is low, but they are in the spleen, and they will deliver during the bleeding, and they are high-quality platelets. And there is no evidence that to give FFP or recombinant factor 7 will make any difference in protecting these patients. For the reason, usually, it's not done. You just increase intravascular space. Why should you be using antibiotics? And the reason is that these patients are at very high risk of infections just for the fact that they are bleeding. And we know that around 60% of them will develop an infection during that admission. And around one of every three of the one-third of these 60%, that means 20% of the patients, will be infected already at the moment of admission, and 40% will do it while they are in the hospital. The most common infections is going to be urinary tract infection, and then SBP. I mean, the fact that the patient has no ascites doesn't mean that they are free of the risk of infection. A number of them will have pneumonia, and a number of them will have bacteremia. The only patient where it's not very clear that antibiotic will make any benefit is in the patient who is a child PUA, because the risk of infections on them is quite low, and maybe you can say, well, maybe I will not do it, but what happens often is difficult to think that much, and most of the time they are going to end in antibiotics. But ideally, you don't really have to do it in them. Now, what is the evidence? What is what these antibiotics will do? And this comes from several meta-analyses looking at the use of prophylactic antibiotics in the patients with bleeding. And this is GI bleeding. This is not necessarily variceal bleeding. This is gastrointestinal bleeding in the cirrhotic patient, independently of where the patient is bleeding from. And what we know is that the use of antibiotics decreases mortality by 21%, decreases the risk of infection by 65%, decreases the mortality related to infection by 67%, decreases rebleeding rate by 47%, and decreases the amount of blood needed during the admission from 2.7 to 0.7 units only. Used most of the time, we just tend to use ceftriaxone because most of our patients have one of these features. They have malnutrition, encephalopathy, ascites, jaundice, or they have been receiving quinolones in the past. In that situation, you have to use ceftriaxone. But in other patients, you could use a quinolone orally. These are the doses and of the drugs, the vasoactive drugs that we utilize during the gastrointestinal bleeding. And you can see what we use in the United States is usually octreotide, because that's the one we have. We have octreotide and vasopressin. Octreotide usually is used for 5 days, initially with a bolus of 50 mics and then 50 mics per hour. Vasopressin we don't use. If you are going to use it, you have to use it with nitroglycerin because it tends to cause a spasm of coronary arteries and the patient may lose a few fingers or toes or the tip of the nose. But if you use vasopressin, you use it for a shorter period of time because it's not a very benign drug. In Europe, they can use somatostatin that perhaps is a little better than the octreotide, or they use terlipressin. Again, these drugs will be for 5 days. When the patient comes bleeding actively and is bleeding from varices, then you have to try to treat that. And the therapy of choice is going to do banding. And you can have these band devices that have multiple bands that you're going to deliver one by one in order to treat the acute hemorrhage. And then after that, after you control that, you are likely to continue treating the patient to eradicate the varices to protect the patient from bleeding again. Also, banding can be used, as I mentioned before, for primary prevention. Okay, this is a meta-analysis that looks at the comparison of the effectiveness of variceal ligation as compared with endoscopic sclerotherapy. And the reason endoscopic ligation is superior is from all these analyses. And you can see every time everything favors the use of ligation over sclerotherapy from the point of view of rebleeding and mortality. Also, the rate of complications of banding is much lower than that of sclerotherapy. Sometimes you have to do sclerotherapy because the banding doesn't work well or because the tissue is just too stiff. Once the patient is treated endoscopically, the question is, should I still continue my octreotide or not? And what the evidence is that the patients do better if you do the endoscopy and you continue your octreotide or your vasoactive agent. And again, the length of time that you're going to be using octreotide, or if you use terlipressin in the future, or somatostatin will be 4 or 5 days. Why is that we have to be careful in how much blood we give to these patients? And this comes from the same study of Villanueva that I mentioned before, look at patients with peptic disease. And most importantly, patients with cirrhosis, because the strength of the data is the patients who have portal hypertension. And again, this, as I mentioned before, the patients were randomized to receive either a hemoglobin goal of 7 or higher, around 7, between 7 and 8, or more liberal with a goal of around 10. 9 to 11 is what was defined. And this is what happens if you have a patient who is a Child-Pugh A or B. If you are placing the patients and they are in the lower goal in blue versus the higher goal in purple, you see that the purple ones, more blood, give you more mortality and give you more rebleeding. And this is statistically significant. And in the child C, there is no evidence in mortality because they tend to die easily anyway, but the rebleeding rate is increased by giving more blood. And that's why, again, you always do restrictive transfusions. Another thing that is important is to try to identify the patients who need or will get benefit from having early tips. And these are always, this is the use of cover tips, that is the only one that we use in the United States anyway. And this is a study that was done by Garcia Pagan in Barcelona, who took patients who came, this is a particular group of patients. These are patients who are Child-Pugh B, who at the time of endoscopy have active bleeding, or who are Child-Pugh C. And I already mentioned that this is the group of patients who is in this very high risk of failure to therapy or rebleeding in the initial few days. And what he did is the patient were randomized to receive medical therapy. Medical therapy is octreotide plus a beta blocker plus ligation versus medical therapy, again, antibiotics. That is antibiotics plus beta blockers plus ligation plus TIPS. And this procedure, the TIPS, was done in the initial 24 to 72 hours. And this is what we have here. The rebleeding rate and the patient who received TIPS, in this case in purple, is much lower that in the ones who did not receive the TIPS, and this is expected. Number needed to treat 2.1 patients. From the point of view of hepatic encephalopathy, and in general you think that TIPS will give you more encephalopathy, that was not the case. The frequency of encephalopathy was lower in the TIPS patient, and this is because they are having less episodes of bleeding, and bleeding also causes encephalopathy. And survival was much better on the patients who received the TIPS at 6 weeks, and it's still true at 1 year. And that's why these particular patients, Child-Pugh B with active bleeding at the time of endoscopy, or Child-Pugh C with or without active bleeding at the time of endoscopy, if they are candidate for TIPS, they should have an early TIPS. If everything fails and you try to control the patient endoscopically, but you cannot control it, you will try to press over the varices to control the bleeding, and you can use a Minnesota tube. We don't use St. Stack in Blackmore, Minnesota. It's the same tube that has a larger balloon and has a ports to clean. In that way, you know if the patient is bleeding. And initially, what you do is you just place the tube and you inflate the gastric balloon, and then you pull a pressure with a weight of 1 to 2 pounds of weight. Yeah, and that pressure will compress the varices at the AG junction and stop bleeding. If that fails, then you're going to inflate the esophageal balloon at a pressure that is estimated around the mean pressure of the varices. That works in some degree, and it's very annoying, but we do it 2-3 a year. What is being used a little more often, but not in the United States yet much, is the use of stents. And these are stents are available in some parts of Europe, but not in the United States. They are simple to place. They come with a balloon in the lower part, and you just drive the shaft. You inflate the balloon, pull, and deliver the stent. And that seems to be even more effective than to use the balloon. And you can keep them there for a relatively prolonged period of time. If the patient, and the reason you use this balloon or you place this stent is to have more time to prepare, and what you are trying to do is to prepare to do a TIPS procedure. And TIPS is very effective as a rescue treatment. The bleeding control of TIPS is around 90%, the rebleeding rate is 16 to 30%. The mortality, however, is still meaningful, 20 to 30%. These patients are quite ill. The 30-day survival, 67%. And the predictors of poor survival are if the patient is older, if you have to do it as an emergency, that means you cannot stabilize the patient at all. If they have elevated, meaningfully elevated liver enzymes or high bilirubin, and high bilirubin is very important, or if they have a previous history of TIPS encephalopathy, not related to the bleed. If they have episodes of encephalopathy, not related to bleed, they could sometimes decompensate and get in a lot of trouble. In general, we do this up to usually males of 18. Sometimes we extend it to 20. And this is the way a TIPS looks. So it's basically you go to the transjugular approach, enter the atrium, then go to the cava, enter the hepatic veins, and then you make a needle go through until you find the porta, then you make a track, inflate the balloon, and deliver this stent that will allow the blood to easily go from the porta to the hepatic vein, decreasing the pressure over the varices. There are contraindications for TIPS, and it's important to know if the patient has heart failure, is going from a high-pressure system to a high-pressure system, that doesn't help anybody. The patient will have worsening of the failure and will die from heart failure. If the patient has severe pulmonary hypertension with pressure of 45 millimeters, you know, that pressure is still too high, certainly much higher than 12. For that reason, the patient is going to continue bleeding. If the patient has polycystic liver disease, you cannot place the TIPS. There is no support for it in the tissue. Or if they have a severe hepatic failure because they will die of you have no vessels to connect, or the patient has very bad tricuspid valve because you cannot control the pressures. And there are relative contraindications that include the pressure of infection. You can develop endotipsitis, that is infection of the tips that will remain there until you remove the tip, but you cannot remove it unless you give it quick in your liver. Or poorly controlled encephalopathy, or vascular tumors, very hypervascular tumors of the tumor, or vessels that are not of good quality makes it more difficult. But we do it sometimes on these patients. Okay, what should you do in that case in summary? The patient comes with acute esophageal variceal hemorrhage. You are going to start immediately your vasoactive drugs, octreotide. You are going to place the patient in antibiotics for 7 days. You are going to start a conservative blood transfusion protocol, trying to get the hemoglobin from around 7 to 8. And again, as I mentioned, you place this patient in antibiotics. That is going to be most of the time the use of triazone for a total of 7 days. In addition to that, you will do an endoscopy in the initial 12 hours to try to find out what's going on and try to treat the problem. If the patient is found to have a variceal source or you suspect that was the source, then you have to make plans for endoscopic variceal ligation. If the patient is a child PUC or a child PUB with active bleeding, you are going to make plans for an early TIPS if the patient can tolerate that and has no contraindication. If the patient in whom you do an early TIPS, you don't have to continue beta blockers or anything else. You stop the other drugs because you don't need them anymore. And if patients in whom TIPS is that's it, I guess. I think I wrote it twice. Okay. Once the patient has had the first episode of bleeding, he's likely to keep doing it and doing it and doing it, and then he gets better and goes to heaven. For that reason, you have to make a plan of what to do to protect the patient. And if you do no therapy, 60% of them will bleed within a year, inside this year. And if you decide just to do a sclerotherapy, that is what we used to do in the very old times, they still have a very high risk of bleeding, around 45%. If you do beta blockers alone, they still have a meaningful risk of bleeding. For that reason, the drug of therapy, the intervention of therapy is to do a combination of beta blockers plus band ligation, endoscopic variceal ligation. This is what we always try to do in all the patients, unless it's impossible to do it. And this is a meta-analysis that looks at the rebleeding rate and the mortality of the patients who receive endoscopy plus drug therapy versus the one who receive only drug therapy. As you can see, in general, there is a preference because they do better in combination therapy for both situations, for rebleeding rate and mortality. And that's why these patients always are treated with dual therapy, unless it's not possible because of other reasons. And these are the drugs that you utilize for the patients to treat once they have had the first variceal bleeding, the drugs and the intervention. As you can see, carvedilol is not there anymore. And the reason carvedilol is not there is because it has not been properly studied on this particular group of patients. It may work fine, but also in theory, because these patients tend to have more advanced disease, and carvedilol drops the pressure more and tends to cause more renal dysfunction. The management is exactly the same. These patients are going to, if you, in drugs, they are going to do band ligation plus a drug, and the titration is the same that I mentioned before, for dasprocopranolol or nadolol, and if you do band ligation, again, it should be always with a beta blocker. It's important to know that the non-selective beta blocker is the main component of the therapy, and if the patient cannot tolerate it, you may have to think, maybe I should go and just do a TIPS on this patient if he is a candidate for that. A number of patients cannot do well in the presence of beta blockers, and we know that if the patient has evidence of refractory ascites, the mortality of these patients goes dramatically higher in the presence of beta blockers. For that reason, patients who have refractory ascites, they should have this discontinue if the blood pressure, systolic blood pressure is less than 90, or they develop acute kidney injury or hyponatremia. If the abnormality of the acute kidney injury was triggered by something else, after you fix it, you can try to reintroduce them, but you have to be careful because these patients tend to get in trouble. Another form of variceal bleeding is the one that comes from the stomach, not from esophageal varices, but from gastric varices. And there are several subtypes of gastric varices. You can have the GOB, the British don't know how to spell esophagus yet for some reason, but they call it GOB1. And GOB1 is the same that esophageal varices. It's a continuation of the esophageal varices, and you treat them identical. You are going to do band ligation or sclerotherapy or whatever. And then comes GOB2. GOB2, they are really unhappy varices. They tend to be quite large, and they tend to bleed badly, and they are difficult to control. And then there is this one that is called isolated gastric varices type 1, and that is what you see only in splenic vein thrombosis, and the treatment of this is a splenectomy. They have a very high bleeding risk. 90% of them will bleed. For the reason you find this, you remove the spleen, you vaccinate them first, and then you remove the spleen, and they are fine. On these other ones, again, we will go over how you treat that. And then there are these isolated varices type 2 that are ectopic. They are in other places. The risk of them bleeding is not that high, and they are uncommon. And then you do whatever you can. Most of the time you inject or band or whatever you can. The data on that is scanty. Now, what is the risk of bleeding depends of the type of varices. And if you have a GOB, that is the one that continues from the esophagus, and you treat like esophagus, then the risk of bleeding is around 25%. The large GOB varices type 2, the ones on the fundus of the stomach, have a 60% chance of bleeding. And the ones who are isolated gastric varices for splenic vein thrombosis, that 90%. The other ones, as I mentioned, is lower. The frequency of varices, the most common type of varices is EOB1, 70%, and the second most common is EOB2, that is 24%. As you can see, this group is overrepresented because they bleed much more often than the EOB1, and is overrepresented as a cause of variceal bleeding, and that variceal bleeding tends to be quite serious. We know that, in general, 10 to 50% of all the variceal, bleeding from GOB2 represents 10 to 50% of all the patients with variceal bleeding. But it's a group not very large, but it still is a meaningful group. The lifetime risk of bleeding is 60%, and when they bleed a good amount, around 5 units every time. And the risk of bleeding goes up as the diameter is larger. Varices of 1 centimeter or larger at a very high risk of bleeding. In addition, the risk increases as the patient decompensates further, having a higher risk in child C than in B, and B higher than in A. The annual bleeding rate for child C is around 60%, and for the child A is much lower, it's around only 4%. The mortality for each one of these episodes is much higher than esophageal varices, it's around 50%, and the rebleeding rate also is very high, around 30%. These varices are to be very large and very difficult to band, Sometimes you have to try to place a loop around them, but they are very, very difficult to control. We don't have good endoscopic therapies in the United States, but they are very good in other places. And some places in the United States will do injection with cyanoacrylate. The problem is that you are likely to end in court every time that something goes wrong, and something goes wrong with some degree of frequency because it's not approved. That is, of course, a crazy thing. If you have a GOB2, that's the large varices from the fundus, not related to splenic vein thrombosis, this is the risk of bleeding at 1 year, 16%, at 2 years, 25%, at 3 years, 36%, at 5 years, 44%. And as I mentioned before, the lifelong risk is around 60%. What should you do if you find these varices? If they have never bled, you can try to do primary prophylaxis. But primary prophylaxis has not been studied properly. And what I will say is that whatever I'm saying here, you have to take with a good amount of spice. But in general, what you do is what you do for other ones because you don't have anything better to do. And what you are going to do is just to use a non-selective beta blockers for these patients and just hope for the best. In general, it's not recommended to do tips or balloon occlusion of the varices, at least in the United States, as a prevention of bleeding for the first time. It's done in Japan, however. When they find these varices, they just go and tend to destroy. The treatment for the acute bleeding, ideally, is going to be cyanoacrylate, but cyanoacrylate may embolize to other parts, and in some places, what they do is they do a combined angiographic and endoscopic procedure. When they go angiographic and they place a balloon in the outlet of the vessel where the varices drains to the low pressure system, most of the time in the spinal, in the gastrorenal shunt, they place a balloon. In that way, when they inject the varices, whatever goes inside, this solid material that is going to be the cyanoacrylate, also known as crazy glue, is not embolized to other parts, causing a stroke or the pulmonary emboli or a myocardial infarction. But again, this is not still the most common way, certainly in the United States. It's quite effective in hemostasis, 90%, but can have ectopic embolization, and the rebleeding rate is meaningful. At 3 days, it's 7%, at 3 months, it's 10%, and at 1 year, it's around 10%. Most of the time, if you do this, the patients are also later going to have a TIPS, and then you are going to try to keep a lower pressure on these patients because these patients bleed at lower pressure than esophageal varices. You want the pressure less than 8. You can use vasoactive drugs and antibiotics because you do that in all patients with GI bleeding. And another technique that you can use is something called BRTO or balloon occluded retrograde transvenous obliteration, or a combination of BRTO plus TIPS. You can temporize while you're preparing to do any angiographic technique by using the Minnesota tube to compress the varices or a Linton Nachlass tube that has a larger balloon of 700 cc, but has only one balloon. It's not like in Minnesota that has a esophageal balloon. And here it doesn't make any difference because the varices is from the stomach. You can use this technique, balloon occluded retrograde transvenous obliteration, that is quite good. But in order to do that, you need to have, for the patient to have a gastrorenal shunt that is present in around 85% of the patients who have these kind of varices. And basically what they do, I will tell you how effective it is. It's quite effective in control, around 90%. The bleeding rate is quite low. And the eradication of varices is quite high, 75 to 100%. But the patients may develop complications. They can develop fever, ascites, pleural effusion, and the varices in other places may get worse. The way the procedure is done is, the drawing is wrong, but I cannot draw for the reason I just use whatever I got. You enter to the cava, and then you enter to the renal vein and find this communication, and then you place a little balloon here, and you advance a catheter that you have left in front of the balloon, and then you inject something that is going to occlude the vessel, a sclerosing agent. And that, you just keep the balloon there and just hope for this to solidify, and you keep the balloon for a few hours. And that will stop the bleeding. If the patient, like in this case, has a TIPS, you have to place a second balloon here to prevent things to go rapidly and embolize to other parts because this is a low-pressure system too. If the patient has no TIPS, you may be able just to occlude this lumen, or if you want to be super safe, you can occlude both lumens with the balloon. Well, in general, the management of these patients is similar to all other patients. You are going to do, again, also restricted transfusions. You are going to patients who have bleeding from gastroesophageal varices type 1 are going to be treated like the ones who have bleeding from varices. They are going to continue having endoscopic therapy, plus beta blockers. Patients who have gastroesophageal type 2 for isolated gastric varices should ideally receive also a TIPS, or they can have a TIPS in combination with the BRTO in order to control them, or in combination with a cyanoacrylate. What else can you do? In patients who have recovered from the bleeding, you are going to keep them non-selective beta blockers if they have the type 1, that is the one that continues from the esophagus, yes, beta blockers plus endoscopic therapy. And for the type 2, you are going to do the combination of TIPS and BRTO or cyanoacrylate. All right. Goodness. Sorry for the torture, but this is the end of this. Any questions? Yep.
So you say don't give FFP to control INR in patients with cirrhosis.
Yeah, there's no evidence that that's anything other than to increase the intravascular space. And when you increase the intravascular space, you increase the portal pressure, and when you increase the portal pressure, you need more.
Okay.
And that's why you do restrict the, as a matter of fact, the reason the patients who had liberal transfusion, the reason they bled more is because they were increasing the viscosity of the blood and the portal pressure. And both of them affect the risk of bleeding. And that was proven on the study by Villanueva to measure the portal pressure on these patients.
What about patients who are on anticoagulants for cirrhotic and have a high INR?
Well, that's a different story. Now, this is a therapeutic form, and you can try to bring them to a reasonable to a reasonable value. Again, you know the INR in the cirrhotic patient is completely fake. It doesn't predict that you cannot form clots, right? That these patients clot all the time, the portal vein, they do DVTs, they do pulmonary emboli, again, all these things happen on these patients just because they can clot as much as anybody else. The regular techniques that we utilize to measure coagulation on these patients are not very reliable. The one of the best ways to have a better idea is to do thromboelastography, but has not been completely standardized either, and the tree of decision is not completely done of how to handle it. But thromboelastography looks at the quality of the clot. Basically, you place blood in a container and you have a thing that moves, and as the clot forms, the resistance increases and you make a curve of resistance. And as time goes longer, the clot starts to dissolve for the passage of lysis and the resistance decreases. And that gives you a curve that looks like something increasing and then something decreasing in size. And that tells you about the strength of the clot, the rapidity of formation, and the rapidity of dissolution of the clot. And that really tells you better about the function of coagulation. But we do it in transplantation, we do it in some of our patients, that take forever to get it done. Yep. Yeah.
What that same shaking in like DIC and then the bleeding is called liver failure. So
what about that?
At DIC
and
then liver failure and like the factor rate levels pointed with say more DIC or so, would you give
You don't know. DIC in these patients is the It's difficult sometimes to be sure if they are truly they are seeing because they have so many factors going on. I don't know what the answer to that is. What is the true management for these patients? I don't think that is known what is the level to handle them. Oh, I was sleeping on that last.
If beta blockers plus EVL is increasing bleeding risk more than beta blockers or EVL alone, then how can you start beta blockers and stop doing EGD for surveillance?
Oh, because they have, because most of the patients are going to be protected and they are not going to need to leave band. Once they bleed, now you start band.
Okay.
They have to prove that they misbehave. You cannot slap everybody in anticipation. Doesn't work as an education for the children. I try to be important. Yep.
If you had to pick one beta blocker, what would you choose?
If a patient has a reasonable blood pressure, carvedilol is a better choice for primary prophylaxis. And that has been studied, and if it's a better choice. Again, depends on how good the blood pressures are. I like to keep my patients with mean arterial pressure pain for higher than 94. They are less likely to get in trouble with renal loss. Yep.
Was the TIPS, the early TIPS indications for Q, B, and C, did they control for venous pressures, or is that sort of the idea? Because it seems like
Yeah, well, in general, these patients, the reason the study was done is because they knew that this is what identified patients with higher pressure. You know, in the study was done in Spain, and in Spain, everybody who goes to a liver center is going to have portal pressure measured. Hello, how are you? Let me measure your portal pressure.
They
knew that these patients have, we know that the child C, the majority of them have very high portal pressure.
Right.
And the same, they know that the bees who have active bleeding have very high portal pressure.
Right.
And that was the reason of the design of the study, because they are the ones who tend to bleed, and that's the reason that particular group was targeted as part of the study.
So I'm just wondering, is did they try and max out beta blockers?
No. These patients were already in some form of therapy.
Okay.
They were already in something.
I see.
And they had a bad day, or they were nothing because they didn't know. But the majority of these patients were known to the system. Yeah. Yep.
With beta blockers worsening ascites, do you take them off the beta blocker for refractory after they're on maximum medical therapy, or when do you pull the trigger?
Yeah. Well, if the patient develops refractory ascites, the patient is likely to develop abdominal syndrome, and it's likely to try to go to hell. And for that reason, usually what you do is, if the indication of the beta blocker was meaningful varices, what you try to do is ban them and then discontinue them. In the meanwhile, you treat this patient with refractory ascites, basically as a abdominal syndrome, because the reason they get in trouble, if you look at the data, is because the mean arterial pressures are low. And if you are able to improve the mean arterial pressures, they may start improving. You just have to treat them as a abdominal syndrome, and you have enough time to discontinue the drugs. And just to mention, to be sure, there is always a lot of confusion about this mean arterial pressure, because the tendency of everybody when you look at mean arterial pressure is to calculate mean arterial pressure. And that's why, because everybody learned that how you know the mean arterial pressure is because you do the formula and then you know the magic number. And that is not true anymore in most of the cases. If you are measuring the pressure yourself, and you're doing this, you are measuring systolic and diastolic with your stethoscope and your cough. For that reason, the mean arterial pressure is calculated. When you do blood pressures by automated systems, all of them measure the mean arterial pressure. They don't measure systolic and diastolic. The systolic and the diastolic is calculated by the system, just using an algorithm. And you try to regress from that algorithm and recalculate the mean arterial pressure, is going to come off. For the reason, you do not calculate mean arterial pressure unless you ask the nurse, or you, if it was done with the old-fashioned way with the stethoscope, or you did it yourself in the stethoscope. And you can't even find the regular blood pressure system anymore in the hospital. So to get on, you have to push one there. Everything is the automated system. For that reason, again, I want to be sure that you guys realize that you do not calculate your arterial pressure most of the time. You have asked. The problem is that they are not written. And the problem that in surgery, sometimes they are calculated by the stupid computer, assuming that the systolic and the diastolic are real. For the reason, you have to, and you may find sometimes in surgery that there is two mean arterial pressures. One is calculated and the other is the real one. You have to ask your friend the nurse and tell me the truth now. Which one is the real one? If one has decimals, you know it's fake. That can save you some time. Okay.